backdrop. While all this is going on, and the Church of England is living the schizophrenic world, or the Catholic, or the Protestant, Catholic, Protestant, back and forth. During this generation, a different style, there are immigrants who are leaving England and bringing their faith with them to this piece of real estate west of the British Isle called America. Each group that lands in a different part of America brings a different expression of the Church of England. Each one saying, "We're Church of England." "No, we're Church of England." "No, we're Church of England." Each of them, "Yes, yes, yes." But they don't quite look like each other. They have to figure out how they can be the Church of England together. And as the Church of England tries to wrestle with some of these questions, there's another firestorm brewing in Boston called, and the spark for the American Revolution begins. Those in the American Revolution are now looking at the English Church with a suspicion about, are you traitors? Are you going to keep your allegiance to the English Church? If so, we're going to have a problem. So the English Church in America quickly decides to distance itself from its English parent and tries to set up its own reality. Once the revolution is over, those who were sympathetic, those of the Episcopal, those of the Anglican clergy who were sympathetic to England, if they weren't imprisoned or fled to Canada, who changed to become American, decided to change the name from Anglican Church to distance themselves from England, and changed it to, let's come up with a new name. How about Episcopal? So they came up with the name Episcopal Church. Caveat. The early leaders of the Episcopal Church were also the early leaders of the American government. And the leaders of the American government, as they're fashioning this thing called Congress, with its checks and balances, thought, well, if it's good enough for the country, it's good enough for the church. As the Episcopal Church emerges, we have a presiding bishop who's analogous to the president, we have a house of bishops that's analogous to the Senate, and we have a House of Deputies that's analogous to the House of Representatives. We are governed not by a sovereign, not by a pope, but by a convention. In a democratic turn of events, our supreme authority in America is not a person, but a collective. The National Convention. It meets every 3 years to determine the directions that we go, and many of the, well, that's it, the directions that we go. And there's not just one language, but we are a church of many languages. We produce our prayer book in many languages, and we conduct our services in many languages. When posed with the question, well, what do you believe, especially about the Eucharist? Is it the real presence? Is it the memorial? What is it? We have a good answer. The answer is, it's a mystery. That's pretty much our answer to every conflict that comes up. As the Church of England settled in America with its different variations, the American Church had to hammer out its differences. We as a church do not have a strict doctrine about much of anything because we can't. Our membership covers a span of Protestant and Catholic beliefs. We live under the same roof, and that roof is called the mystery of God. That's why we here also have many beliefs, and it's fine. You want to believe more Catholic? That's good. Good for you. You want to believe more Protestant? That's fine. We can sit in the same pews, and you don't even have to decide which side. We're all one body. To some, that's a great comfort. To some, they don't get it. I want clarity. Where do I sign on the dotted line? There's no dotted line here. It's mystery. It's a lot of personal faith development and growth. We have certain guideposts. But a lot of it is scripture, reason, and tradition. We believe in personal responsibility for faith decisions. But some find that comfortable, some find it challenging. As I said, scripture, tradition, and reason are still very much a part of the American church. And when it comes time to which do you believe, is there a litmus test for being an Episcopalian? The answer is no. We don't have wars. We don't have fights. We don't have persecutions. We have conversations. That's how we settle it. The old idea was, are you going to fight about this? No, we do lunch. Saints. With a nod to our Catholic heritage, with a nod to our Protestant heritage, we have added to the calendar of saints, although we don't call them saints, we call them holy women and men, that include a variety of contemporary figures, some Christian, some even non-Christian, but contemporary figures to whom we do not pray to them as intercessors, but we use their lives as examples of God through living. So these holy men and women are added to our calendar of saints, but it's still the personal relationship that we have with God that allows us to pray directly to God. In conclusion, again, historians, forgive. My hope was simply to give basic trends, the early church's absolute need for unity. But where that unity became so restrictive, pushback was inevitable into the Protestant Reformation. But when that pushback became so far, the beauty of the Anglican Church was to pull the sides together. And that's a tradition that we have inherited in America in the Episcopal Church. The Episcopal Church is now in various countries around the world, but there's room for all of us. Many cultures still prefer the unity and clarity of the Catholic Church, some the Protestant Church, and some the Anglican in between. My hope is that this gives you something to reflect on, a place to see God in the development, in the growth, and in the gaps. There's so much that we have to learn, so much that we have, so much room for us to grow. The gospel lesson was Jesus promising us the advocate to lead us into all truth. Well, we're on our way. And our belief is that we get there basically through scripture, tradition, and reason. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for your indulgence of time, and the peace of the Lord be always with you.